Even in this going to increase the number of witnesses that are set out on these church terms. You saw the law witnesses in the state of non-permissible. 2 Corinthians 13:1, this is the third time I'm coming to you, and I'll be your witnesses shall ever be established. We saw the law witnesses will be stated in the past of witnesses, verses 5, 9, and 20, is an elderly imagination of the 4, 2, or 3 witnesses. We saw the law witnesses in the definitely false witnesses will be stated in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 28 and 31. And we saw the law witnesses in the New Testament, which is witnesses which are watching us even now, Hebrews chapter 12, watching us as we run that we run our race. We saw the law witnesses require fast to give account to their congregation, Hebrews 13:7 and Hebrews 13:17. We saw the law witnesses extends to their tribulation period, Revelation chapter 11, verses 3 and 4. I think if you can point out a series about witnesses, and you are his witnesses. Now that you pick up on that in part 2, divide and multiply. Presence number 1, we saw the passage we just read tonight, is multiplication cannot happen without multiple witnesses. God doesn't really add God multiplies. And so we find multiple witnesses now are going to be going out on this next missionary journey. God always makes sure that it happens when men don't do what they are called to do. They spend a long time, they're adding up, it's a wonderful time, the time of fellowship. There are
they were making an impact on their
the end result perfectly glorifies him, no matter how bad it is. You can think of Sodom and all the other wicked people, men, and, you know, think of the baddest person you can think of. God allows wickedness to a certain extent. It is only to the extent that it will ultimately, within his eternal sovereign plan, which we do not see all of it in us, that it will glorify him. That's as far as it allows to go. And then it says it, that's all. That's the last one of verse. The remainder of wrath shall God restrain. Even the wrath of man shall praise thee, the remainder of wrath shall God restrain. God so controls it that it never goes to the point where something happens that will not ultimately bring glory to God. And so as we look at the bad things happening in this passage, we look at it and say, that's terrible. Two Christians being equal fighting, in fact, being in such a fight that they separate one from another. God never lets anything happen that does not ultimately count for his glory. And it stops at the point where it no longer count for his glory. We see this in Romans chapter 9, starting in verse 10. And not only this, but what Rebecca also had been deceived by the mom, even by our father Isaac. For the children be not yet born. Not having been any good people, but the purpose of God, according to the election, might stand, not of works, but in the call. And here they are, still in Rebecca's womb. It was said to her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, now here's God making a choice before two, three, and four, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. What should we say then? Is there a righteousness with God? God forbid. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. And it tells us in the next verse, it's not a matter of free will. So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, now listen to this, because this is precisely what's going on. God uses bad things to accomplish his purpose. He controls the bad things and the bad people, so that when they will give the greatest amount of glory, and he cuts them off before they can go beyond making glory. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. When Pharaoh was conceived, there were thousands of possibilities of different meanings to be conceived at that moment. Thousands of spurs, two to more than eight. God made sure that the one specific one won the race. Because God was determined that a particular individual rise from the throne of Egypt, because God was going to demonstrate his own purpose, his own power, and his own glory in the child who was conceived and born, and that it would be at a precise point in human history when God let his people go from Egypt. But Paul said in Romans chapter 9, a powerful stuff for all people to like that. And so then men will argue against that. But verse 18 is about, therefore I have mercy on whom I have mercy, and whom he will, he hardeneth. Thou wilt say then unto me, why I have yet my own fault, for whether it is his will. You can't fight God like that. So why does he blame us? That's the argument. Nay, O man, who art thou that blasphemes God? Shall the thing form say in the form that by astounding us? Have thou the potter power over the clay, and this is well, not less than God, than the difference between clay and a potter, because a potter is made out of dirt, just like a potter is made out of dirt. There's a humongous difference between God and us than the difference between potter and clay. And yet we're wrong. Willing to admit it, the potter has power over the clay, the potter determines how to make a vessel out of that. Had thou the potter power over the clay, I would say, well, make one vessel of honor. And I had a single make another excellent design. And then Paul raises the question, what if God, willing to show his wrath, that God is willing to demonstrate all of his attributes in and through his creation and what he does in relation to it. And part of that is wrath and judgment against sin. And so he asks the question, what if God, willing to show his wrath and to release his covenant, endured with much long suffering, put up with it for a long time, the vessel of wrath into the destruction, and he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had before prepared unto glory. God is he, like a potter, making pots. And he has so been, he's making his students. Pointing those of the back. And he can make some of those, not the same old clay, into beautiful vessels, which will be used to paint prior to the old gold decaying roses and flowers. They might have made known the riches of his glory and the vessels of mercy which he had before prepared in glory. Even us he had called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. God takes bad things, bad people, and bad circumstances, and uses them for his glory and miracle as an example of that. Just a few verses earlier in chapter 8, the ultimate principles of Romans chapter 8, verses 28 and 30. And we know, not yes, not what's supposed, not evil, not what cross our fingers and then, you know, roll the dice. We know that all things work together for good, to the benefit of God, to the benefit of the call, according to his purpose. God has an ultimate purpose, and that purpose is to bring glory to himself. And the way in which he has ordained all of creation, ultimately, the way he brings about glory to him, because it manifests and shows forth every aspect of his divine character and his divine nature. It brings him complete glory, the full spectrum, the full world of who he is. We know all things work together for good, and that love God, but then we call according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, that he also did also predestinate, and being conformed with the image of his Son, he might have been the firstborn among many brethren. For whom he did predestinate, then he also called. And whom he called, then he also justified. And whom he justified, then he also glorified. I pointed out before, I pointed out again, we're not yet glorified, but we are glorified. Because there are elites all the way back to the purpose of God, and the sorrow of Paul, the choice of God, not merely that he was going to happen, but because he chose the plan and his purpose that would best produce his glory. And so he sees us completing the Christ, then he also glorified. Principle number three, and this I think is fascinating in light of the sovereignty of the purposes of God we just looked at in principle two. Principle number three is, God uses individual personalities and purposes to accomplish his will. We see that very stated for us here in verse 3 or 4. Notwithstanding, it pleased Silas to abide there still. Silas decided he was going to stay. All the rest of them set out. Silas decides to stay. Now God used that choice of Silas because later Paul mentioned Silas. When Paul learns to set up the next couple of verses, Silas can be available. God uses individual personalities and preferences to accomplish his will. Now think about this for a second. Did you know about the 2nd century that the God used when he inspired his word? This book was written over many centuries by multiple different authors. Authors who had different parents, different backgrounds, different training, different gifts, different linguistic abilities. They go all the way from clergymen, all the way down to fishermen. They go all the way from scholars to lawyers. God used many different kinds of people to write the Bible. But God used individuals.
But you know, even in cases like that,
about his greatest amount of glory. Barnabas determined to take with him John, whose surname was Mark. But the whole thought not who had taken him with them, who departed from the Pamphylia and went not with them to the work. Two different men, Barnabas and Paul. Two different personalities, both God and man, but two different personalities. And they have argued over whether or not taking the young man with them. Barnabas wants to redeem him. Paul says, he's done, I'm through with him. I don't want to work with him. Barnabas has a spirit of reconciliation. Paul had a warrior spirit, the spirit of warfare. Now, you know what you look at the history of the church. Both of those are absolutely necessary in different places and at different times and for different works of ministry. Sometimes the battle needs to be carried forth and there needs to be a warrior in the lead who is trampling down the enemy, swinging the sword with their own heads. Sometimes the church is wounded and needs to be healed. And the ministry of reconciliation and peace. God uses both. Now you remember we studied God in the past. Remember what we learned about God back in chapter 12. We find him showing up there in verse 12. Peter's just been out of prison. And when miraculously, it says, when we consider that he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together to pray. And as Peter knocked on the door of the gate, an angel came to her and made her open. And when she knew his voice, she opened up the gate of the land for granted and told how he used to go to the gate. And they said to her, thou art mad. Remember what they've been praying for? They've been praying for Peter to be released. They've been praying, oh Lord, we would be rather risen than drop again. But if you decide not to do it, help him be strong to cut off his head. How long will you need our prayers? But she constantly interrupted with even so that they said, it is an angel. But Peter continued, knocking.
Church as they're growing up.
You may hear us surprised that we should walk away from the floor after we finish high school, something that could be as high as 85%. And so we're introduced to this very important young man who's about to step out in faith, although it's a very bold step, the servant of Christ. John Marcus is called Marcus in Colossians 4:10. He's called Marcus by 1924. He's called Marcus in 1 Peter 5:13. Elsewhere he's called John. John has told us that it's the same person. He was raised in Christian home in Jerusalem. A very strong Christian home. I don't know where anything was taking place. It's only in all my memories. He has seen miraculous answers to prayer. He had had first-hand experience with Peter. His mother is a relative of Barnabas, Barnabas' sister. Barnabas was uncle of John Mark, another small Christian family connection. Colossians 4:10 says, there are servants my fellow Christians saluted to Barnabas. Sister, son of Barnabas, such as you receive a man, if he come unto you, receive him. Although he started out with the apostle Paul, he ends up with being the spiritual son of Peter. Perhaps through the very incident that we have here in our text in chapter 12, where Peter is released and comes to that home first after he's out of prison, after the angels get him out. He saw a supernatural hand of God at work. Peter writes in 1 Peter 5:12-13, by so many as a faithful brother, because I suppose I have agreed with the exhorting, and testifying that this is the true grace of God where you stand. The church is at battle, the life together with you saluted to, and so doth Marcus, my son. Peter views him as a spiritual son. Paul wouldn't get him off. Paul's never been at that. Paul wouldn't get him off. So he got another mentor. Another one would take him under his wing, another apostle, because he really wanted to serve Christ, even though he was so wishy-washy at first. And so Peter refers to him as Marcus, my son. Paul refers to Timothy as his son. Paul had Timothy and I as others. But Peter got his son Mark. John Mark wrote to Paul and Marcus on the first missionary journey. That's chapter 12, verses 29. Chapter 13, verse 5, I don't mind to mention, but he left the Perga. You see that in Acts 13, verse 13. We talked about that earlier, and some detail, but let me just remind you why he made it left. Perhaps he was scared by the divine confrontation. And we saw that happening there. But then he left. Chapter 25, or chapter 12, verse 25, chapter 13, verse 5. Chapter 13, now when Paul is coming, he's getting lost, he's getting perfect. In fact, he and John departed from them, returned to Jerusalem. And now this young man, who had such a bad start, is the reason for the fight between Paul and Barnabas. The contention was so sharp in the man 15:39. But they departed asunder one from the other, and so Barnabas took the mark and sailed into the Cyprus. Going back and check on the churches in Cyprus. Paul goes back and check on a bigger group of churches, so they got two complete loops of churches taken care of because of the division. Without the division, it would have taken Paul and Barnabas together a lot longer to go through all of those churches that had been planted on former missionary journeys. We find that there is a point at which John Mark has reconciled to the Apostle Paul. We find that he's with Paul during his first imprisonment in Rome. Colossians chapter 4, verse 7. All my spiritual things declare unto you, as a beloved brother and faithful minister, fellow servant in the Lord, whom I have sent to you for the same purpose, that you might know your state and comfort your hearts, with an essence, a faithful and beloved brother who is one of you. They shall come unto all things which are done here. There is service my fellow Christians saluted to you, and Marcus, sister's son of Marcus, touching whom he received commands, to become unto you,
You make choices
whether or not you hear a word or not. You make choices who you're going to call in the day. You make choices concerning what you're going to spend the money on God's presence in your care as a stewardship. You make choices concerning whether or not you'll be friends with someone or not friends with someone. Whether you will become angry at what they said or by what they didn't say, which you thought should. Some of you have made the major choices concerning marriage. Who you will marry. Some of you have made choices about children, whether or not you exercise birth control or not exercise birth control. Some of you have made choices about the way in which you train your children. Going to school or just to homeschool. You may not make your choices out there. You make them. Every one of our choices has specific consequences for it. Some of us choose to be diligent, some of us choose to be slothful. Some of us choose to be angry, some of us choose to shut it off. Some of us choose to earnestly pursue a particular occupation, a particular career, a particular whatever it is, and others just sort of let it happen. But it's a choice. And choices have consequences. God uses that as glory, but holds us accountable for what we do. God uses it for His glory, but He holds us accountable for what choices we make. Some of that we make choices to, some of that we are making. We're held accountable for the choices we make, and those choices make a difference in time. Those choices also make a difference for eternity. Whether or not we have the rewards or lose the rewards. Whether or not we please Christ or displease Christ. Whether or not we are useful as a vessel unto honor, or we become a vessel unto dishonor, a vessel unto shock. No longer used as useful service. Paul said, I'm preaching diligently because if I mean I should be a castaway, it doesn't mean he uses salvation. It means that he could have gotten set on the shelf as an unuseful instrument. We made choices as to whether we'll obey God or not obey God, whether or not we'll exercise the spiritual gifts that God has entrusted to us or not exercise the spiritual gifts, whether or not we'll wear the fruit of the Spirit or walk in flesh. Choices make a difference not only in time, but when we stand in the judgment seat of Christ, the choices will make a difference in eternity. As to whether or not we hear words well done, not only the faithful servant, and that I will enjoy it by the Lord. Whether or not there will be a trophy there for us, as the works that we've done here are tested by fire, Paul explains that in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And the things that were done in the flesh are all burned up, the things that come through the fire, instead of being like wood, hay, stubble, or like gold, silver, precious stone, which is truly the are gracious. choices that we make. We are specific individuals conceived in the exact right time, brought into this world we were, creating grace in a certain way, learning different things, coming under different influences, hearing different messages from different preachers, reading the Bible for ourselves, and the Holy Spirit giving different messages to us that are necessary for our particular walk, our particular time, our particular circumstances of life. And you brought us to tonight. Once again, they will remind you to make a choice for the day. Some seem so mundane, and yet we don't understand how they fit together in your eternal plan. So don't believe in the creation of the Lord. We will be held accountable. Father, help us to make the right choices. Cause our choices to be informed by the Word of God. Cause our choices to be empowered by the Spirit of God. Cause our